brought to you by Penguin.
On the Shadow Tracks, written and read by me, Clare Hammond. Introduction. On the 8th of November 2015, my colleagues at the Myanmar Times newspaper woke before dawn and queued outside polling stations to vote, many of them for the first time in their lives. We had feared there would be unrest in Myanmar that day. But after casting their ballots, voters strolled calmly through the streets, displaying fingertips stained with purple indelible ink. That night, crowds gathered outside the headquarters of the National League for Democracy, the political party led by Nobel laureate Aung San Suu Kyi, to watch the preliminary vote count flash onto an LED screen. As the scale of the party's likely victory became clear, people across the country spilled onto the streets to celebrate. They waved flags emblazoned with the fighting peacock, the symbol of their 27-year struggle for democracy. It rained that night, and from the heart of the celebrations, our photographers sent images back to the newsroom of exultant, rain-streaked faces turned towards the sky. For 3 days and three nights, my colleagues and I camped out at the office, editing stories filed from across the country. We crowded around a small television to watch the results being announced. When we realised that Aung San Suu Kyi's party would win an absolute majority in Parliament, I watched my colleagues celebrate their own victory. For press freedom, for the right to tell the truth, to record, to remember, to see, and to be seen. Outside the country, and particularly in the West, the election result was hailed as a triumph for liberal democracy in one of the world's most repressive states. At the centre of the story was Aung San Suu Kyi, the Oxford University-educated daughter of Myanmar's independence hero General Aung San. After emerging as the leading figure of the pro-democracy movement in 1988, she had endured 15 years under house arrest, while her supporters had been thrown into colonial-era prisons, where many of them were tortured or killed. With her calm resolve and mantra of peace, Aung San Suu Kyi appeared to stand in sharp and uncomplicated opposition to the military generals who had brutalized Myanmar's people for half a century. Both in Myanmar and in the West, the struggle between the two had been reduced to a simple contest between good and evil. It was this compellingly simple narrative and the exhilarating pace of change in Myanmar that drew me to the country from Hong Kong, where I had been working as a financial journalist. There, I had reported occasionally on the economic reforms that accompanied the political transition, after Myanmar's military handed power to a nominally democratic government led by a former general, Thein Sein. From Hong Kong's financial district, where I spent my days interviewing bankers about share prices and interest rates, I had found the events unfolding in Myanmar intoxicating. In the spring of 2014, I packed up my tiny apartment and moved to Yangon, the largest city in Myanmar and the former colonial capital. I was 26 years old and I had no commitments anywhere else. But when I sat down at my new desk and began editing the business pages of the Myanmar Times, an English language newspaper, I found myself grappling with what was, in fact, a formidably complex history. It was also, I would come to learn, one that was deeply entangled with that of the United Kingdom, my own country. These two histories began to intertwine in 1824, when the British East India Company waged its first war against the Burmese Kombang dynasty. The company already ruled large parts of India and was looking to expand its control over the Asian sea trade. Within three decades, it had seized the long Indian Ocean coastline that stretches from modern-day Bangladesh to the Malay Peninsula on the sea route to Singapore, forcing the Burmese inland. Establishing a new capital at Rangoon, the same city now known as Yangon, where I would live for the next 6 years, Britain waged a third and final war against the Burmese kingdom in 1885 and deposed its king. It annexed not only the Burmese heartland, but a much larger territory, including land inhabited by more than 100 other ethnic groups that live in Myanmar today. At the centre of this diverse territory were the ethnic Burmese, who now make up an estimated two-thirds of Myanmar's population of 54 million. The data on Myanmar's ethnic makeup is considered so sensitive that it's not made public. Parts of the surrounding lowlands were home to rival kingdoms, including the Rakhine in the west and the Mon in the southeast. In the eastern mountains were the Shan states, whose hereditary rulers had paid tribute to the Burmese court. The Shan are now Myanmar's second largest ethnic group, comprising around 10% of the population. Encircling these territories were vast stretches of highland, where hundreds of tribal groups, including the Chin and Kachin, now smaller but sizable minorities, lived in relative isolation, kept apart by the region's mountainous terrain. This territory became known as British Burma. At independence in 1948, rather than dividing it back into separate states, as some ethnic minorities had hoped, the British simply transferred power to Burmese independence leaders in Rangoon. Aung San Suu Kyi's father, General Aung San, had promised ethnic leaders that he would grant them autonomy. But he was assassinated 6 months before independence, and his promise was never kept. Instead, a year after independence, in 1949, the first separatist insurgency broke out. Myanmar has since become home to some of the world's longest-running civil wars. As conflict erupted across the country, one of the Burmese independence heroes, a general called Ne Win, quietly consolidated power over the armed forces. Within just over a decade, he had staged a coup, and soon he established a socialist regime, centralizing the economy and isolating Myanmar from the rest of the world. From 1962, for more than half a century, the military ruled the country. In 1988, when Ne Win's regime collapsed during a national uprising, it was quickly replaced by another military government. By then, Myanmar's armed forces were no longer considered heroes. To hold on to power, they brutally crushed the pro-democracy protests, killing thousands of innocent civilians. Under Than Shwe, a strong man who would remain in power until 2011, they would rule by violent force. More overtly nationalist than Ne Win's regime, the junta that Than Shwe would come to lead changed the country's name from Burma to Myanmar in 1989. It also changed the names of its cities, towns, rivers, and streets, as if to erase all traces of British rule. It promoted Buddhism as the state religion, and it mythologized the pre-colonial past. It also tried to reframe Myanmar's conflicts, propagating the idea that for hundreds, if not thousands of years, the country, meaning the geographical territory demarcated by the British administration and claimed by the modern state, had been home to a fixed number of indigenous, national races, which did not include the Rohingya, a long-persecuted, predominantly Muslim minority. These groups had lived together more or less in harmony, the junta claimed, until the British invaded, violently disrupting this peaceful union and creating deep and lasting divisions. It was the responsibility of everyone in the country, it argued, to restore the nation to its former unity. The problem, of course, was that to the country's ethnic minorities, unity meant submission to the Burmese military. By the time I sat down at my desk in the cavernous colonial-era Myanmar Times newsroom, the country was home to more than 20 established ethnic armed groups and more than 100 militias. Some of these groups had signed ceasefires with Myanmar's military, but none had given up their weapons. Their struggle was complicated by their involvement in the shadowy illicit industries that fund the war, the multi-billion dollar narcotics, timber, jade and gemstones economies, which also function as money laundering schemes for Asia's criminal gangs. But these were the knotty, difficult subjects that I would find myself reporting on in the years to come. For now, as the newsroom hummed with the activity of young reporters, much of this complexity was occluded. Instead, my colleagues profiled their newly elected lawmakers, including former political prisoners, activists, and poets, and wrote optimistic articles about the peace process, which Aung San Suu Kyi would soon make a priority. On the business desk, we wrote about the sunny outlook for the economy, the lifting of Western sanctions, the opening up of the banking and telecom sectors, and Myanmar's first stock exchange. During those heady months, it felt as if the country was moving into a new phase of history. And in that moment, the future for my colleagues had seemed bright and secure. The city we lived in was already beginning to resemble any other Asian metropolis. As the generals stepped back from direct power, people from around the world had flocked to Yangon in their thousands, attracted by what appeared to be vast new opportunities. New shopping malls, luxury condominiums, and high-end hotels proliferated, obscuring the violence of the recent past. There were new nightclubs and bars, where guest DJs flew in from Asian capitals for one-night shows. There were pop-up restaurants, fast food outlets, luxury spas, yoga studios, and state-of-the-art gyms. The city was booming, and at the time I saw this as a further sign that Myanmar was leaving its troubled past behind. As a young journalist, one who had not lived in the country for long and who had never experienced the darkness that in Myanmar is associated with military rule, it was easy to overlook the past. I hardly noticed that the legacy of the military...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.